Well, hello again, my friends, and welcome once more to the Invisible College. Now, I've got a rather special lecture for you today. We're getting into the really quite deep esoteric stuff now. This is really only intended for the college itself. I may release it later on, but for now, anyway, this is only for members of the college. And the lecture today is called Mystery of the Sistine Chapel. And we're going to be looking, it's going to have implications for a lot of our other material that we're going to talk about. But I won't spoil it for you by preempting. But let's go straight into it. The Mystery of the Sistine Chapel. Right, now then, Sistine Chapel, you probably know, is in Rome, in the Vatican City. It's actually in St. Peter's, the great church where, you know, the Pope is resident. And this chapel was actually built and decorated for the popes. I think it was Pope Julius II or something. But anyway, in the early part of the 16th century, it was decorated, and the man who had to do the ceiling was Michelangelo, who we know much better really as a sculptor rather than a painter, but he did do painting as well, in particular this Sistine Chapel. And there's a big commission that wasn't really one that he wanted even, but the Pope kind of insisted, and when the Pope insisted you couldn't really say no. So anyway, he painted the ceiling, and here you can see is in it, all its splendour. And in the centre of it is a famous image that I'm sure you've all seen before. It sort of gives the creation, starting on one side, leading up to the creation of man, which I've circled there with the arrow. And then you have the fall of man, and then other things to do with the redemption of man through Jesus. But the bit that we're interested in is pretty much at the middle of the ceiling, which is this picture here that I'm sure you've seen many times before. That actually used to be used on television. What was it, the South Bank show or something that had that? And they had a little spark going between God's finger and Adam's finger, implying that he's passing on the gift of life. So modern interpretation is the narrow gap between Adam's and God's fingers is a synapse. That's an electrical spark of life passes across it. But I see it rather differently. I think it's Adam separating from God like a baby from its mother when the umbilical cord is cut. At this moment, Adam becomes an individual with free will. Now I want you to take that on board, because this is actually the essence of the whole paradox and problem of human life on Earth, is that our supposed forefather Adam actually really represents the collective human race, certainly the male side of it. I suppose there must have been an individual, but Adam, the word Adam just means man. So it's the fall of man, fall of all men, really. But it's connected with this idea that we were given a free will, but then we made the wrong choice. Or you could say, well, we made a choice and we've had the consequences of that choice. Well, that's the problem with free will, is that you might make the wrong choice, but it still, you have to have the choice. If you haven't got the choice, then you're really just a machine. You're just an AI, or, you know, you're just a robot. Having choice in matters is what makes us truly human. And this seems to be the moment when we are given that choice, at least as I see it, with the separation of Adam from God and becoming an individual. Adam then has the choice. He can either say, right, I want to stay with God, I want to serve him and love him. Or he can decide, well, I want to do my own thing. I want to become wise. I want to have knowledge, follow the serpent path, as it were. and then the consequences come down on you, right? Well, if you're going to be like that, then on your own head be it. So this is kind of a major matter for all of us as to what our situation is going to be. Now, the painting by Michelangelo has excited speculation ever since it was first unveiled. God is shown as a man in late middle age. He's carried along by angels, and you can see some of them. There are other angels underneath him, actually supporting him, and seemingly embraces a figure that could be the Virgin Mary. Maybe she's Eve. I don't know. I call her Mary anyway. Behind him are other souls and angels. But do they have particular meaning? Meanwhile, his heavenly realm appears to move through the sky like a flying kite. You can see that scarf or whatever it is dangling down there. And it looks like the whole thing's moving along through the heavens like a flying kite. And surrounding God and his entourage, billowing out around them as a cloak or blanket. You can see that whole shape that's surrounding, a kind of lozenge shape that's surrounding God, and his arm is poking through it or out of it. It's like a cloak or blanket, and it has a very specific meaning. Does it? Well, could this be meaningful too? Well, now, in 1990, a medical doctor, Dr. Frank Lynn Meshberger, came up with a fascinating new theory concerning this painting. He suggested that the shape of the cloak and some of the other details exactly matched the anatomy of the human brain. You can see a human brain there. And using schematics based on anatomical drawings of both the skull and the brain itself, he concluded that Michelangelo had wanted to get across the idea that the brain, or rather mind, is modelled on God himself. It is our larger brains that differentiate us from other animals. It is having a developed cerebrum that gives us the capacity for self-conscious thought. Now, I'm not going to go into this in great detail, but this Dr. Meshberger, you can find things on the internet about this, and I'm going to put links. I think I've done it here, but I'm going to also put links underneath that you can find an article about this, and so you can go into the detail there. But I just want to show you the basic imagery, and you can see it here. We can see the brain, and look at how that cloak kind of mirrors that brain, or the, you know, the skull that surrounds it. And you can even see, if you look there, that you've got the frontal lobes in front of God, and then underneath that you've got a dip in there where there's an angel, and you can see the dip in, which actually is in our brain, and that kind of curve leading down to the brainstem coming down there. Well, you've got a leg that's coming down there with the scarf, and that seems to be symbolizing the brainstem. So, and it curves around the back, around these other figures of angels, which seem to represent different parts of the cerebrum, which is the outer cortex of the brain, the sort of bit that looks a bit like intestines. You could say that wraps around. It gives it more surface area, actually, by being wrapped around like that. And that seems to be the reason for it. And you can see the inner parts of the brain there, sort of inside God himself. So there does seem to be something in this. When we look at a cross-sectional schematic of the brain and compare this with the God image, there are obvious similarities. These are even more apparent when compared with the detailed diagrams presented in the original article. But is there something more going on? So have a look at that original article, and we're going to press on now. We're going to look at other strange connections between this painting and what it might be representing. Now, here's our old favourite, the constellation of Orion. I've talked about this a lot in all sorts of different lectures. Of course, the Orion Mystery, the book I did with Robert Bovell, Signs in the Sky, we talked a lot about this. I've talked about it in various lectures. And you can see the belt stars there. And you can see dangling down below the belt is this sort of bright area here, which is called the Sword of Orion. you can see all the plasma sheaths. The constellation of Orion is one of the brightest and most recognizable in the sky. Besides prominent stars such as Betelgeuse, that's the red one up the top there, Rigel, which is down in the bottom right-hand corner, and the belt, you can see the belt, the three stars of the belt. It's characterized by clouds of dust and plasma. That's all this sort of red stuff you see around and glowing gas or dust around inside and going through Orion. That big curve you can see there is composed of plasma as well, as is the area at the top there. Now we're going to look at the Great Nebula, which is in the Sword, which dangles down there. And that's the brightest of these nebulae, or the gas clouds, or whatever you want to call it. This is in part because it's the nearest such nebula to our solar system. It's located in the so-called Sword of Orion. Just a few words there. I mean, there are other nebulae in the sky that we can see with telescopes. Big, powerful telescopes reveal these. But they're nowhere near as close to us as this Orion one is. And there's reasons for that that we'll go into in another lecture. But it is a bright nebula, and as such, people who've got good eyesight, which isn't me, not anymore anyway, can actually make out the Orion Nebula. If they look at the Sword, they see it as a kind of smudge, a slightly coloured smudge in that Sword area. And it's an area of intense activities, a lot of stars being created and born there. And therefore, it's excited a lot of interest among astronomers today, which is why we have some really good pictures of it, supplied by NASA from the Hubble telescope. And that's what we're looking at here, of course. So, is Michelangelo's depiction of God a coded image of the Orion Nebula? Now, let's take a global look at that for a minute and compare the two. I think you can see there are similarities there. You can see again that dip on the left hand side. You can see the arm stretching out and the head above it with it seems to be wearing a kind of cap actually on top there, but the head is quite clear there, and we'll be looking at that in more detail in a second. You see the arm stretching out, and you can see the cloak coming down, and there's a dip below the arm, and that seems to correspond again to this dip in the painting that we were looking at before, that corresponded with the skull. And the cloak seems to go all the way around as sort of surrounding the entire image, as sort of a not as dense plasma cloud. You see the area of the breast is much more lit, as is in the actual painting. The actual painting as the breast of God lit up. You can see that in the nebula as well. And behind that, you can see a kind of dark area, and you can see that dark area again repeated, and figures that seem to be ghostly figures in the nebula being echoed somehow in these angels or Mary and what have you behind God. So when we compare the images, we see the head of God with brightness replicated on both images, particularly the face area of God and the nebula. We see the painting arm of God symbolized by a dark cloud. Breast of God is very bright and is symbolized by the bright core of the nebula. And ghostly images of angels' heads can be seen crooked under his other arm. It's almost like a second arm coming around there. Under his other arm is represented by darker plasma that goes around the image. And these are further details of Danny Wilson's analysis. Now, Danny Wilson, I should say, this was not my discovery. There's a guy called Danny Wilson who's put these videos up, and he did a lot of videos back in the day. I remember looking at these and being quite amazed. He seems to have taken a lot of that down now, unfortunately, or he's made them private. But there are still a few things on the internet you can find concerning this work of his. Brilliant insight from my point, I would say. I really congratulate him for finding these connections. Brilliant to have researched this and found the connection, I think, between the constellation of Orion, the nebula in the constellation of Orion, and this painting of God creating Adam in the Sistine Chapel. Now here we can have a closer look at the head of God, and I think you can see it more clearly there. If you look there on the left hand side, you can see faces, an eye, and there's a nose, there's a mouth, and there's a sort of wispy beard that comes back. I mean, it's very clear there, and the sort of hair. I can see that very clearly. Obviously, you know, we're looking at a cloud image formed by a nebula rather than a painting with that, and so it's much clearer in the painting, obviously, but it's definitely there, I think. And when you look again at the arm that's coming out and you compare that with the nebula, it is very, very similar, and you can even see a finger pointing out from it, and the other fingers curling down. I mean, it is extraordinary when you look in this sort of detail at the nebula, and you compare it with the painting that's been done by Michelangelo. And then you can see here the shining heart of God, I call it, the breast area of the figure of God is the brightest part of the painting. And there it is, the really bright center of the nebula. There's a lot of activity there, electrical activity, which has been exciting scientists a great deal, and they've been analysing that area particularly, where there's a group of stars they call trapezium, the huge white giant stars, and other stars being born there. It's a very, very active part of our galaxy, and this area of the galaxy anyway. So we can see here, again you can see God's arm stretching out around. This is the other arm. I can see it coming out round, going round over the top of these figures here. And I've ringed the area I would call Mary. And you can just make out her face at the top of there, going up to that top of the ring that I've drawn. And make out the eyes and the head there. And below it you can see the body of this sort of Mary figure being held in under that arm that's come round. I know it's ghostly, and we're looking at cloud images here, so it's not going to be that clear, but it is clear enough. If you've got enough imagination, you can see it. And you can see that there's a hand coming down as well. You can see the figure of the hand there coming down, and there you can see the figure of the hand of God reaching down as well. Going to this other figure here that we can see, which I call the cherub. So look at those, and you can see there is something in this. You can see here it does mirror the images very clearly between God and Orion, or the nebula, the Great Orion Nebula. So Let's have a little bit of a look now at this this man, Michelangelo, who painted this amazing ceiling in the Sistine Chapel, including the creation of Adam scene that we've been looking at. So where did he come from? What's he all about? And what's his story? Well, he went to Florence at age 13 in 1488, joining the Florentine Academy 2 years later. He stayed until 1492. When the death of Lorenzo de' Medici changed everything. There was a lot of problems in Florence around that time. But while in Florence, he had Pico di Mirandola and Marsilio Ficino as his teachers. These were famous scholars at the Florentine Academy that was set up by the Medicis. And they were Platonists, and teaching the ancient Greek knowledge as much as had come down through Plato, but also the Hermetica. In 1453, at the fall of Constantinople, the Hermetica had been brought west by a fleeing monk and eventually coming to the hands of Cosimo de' Medici, who was the grandfather of Lorenzo. And he had it translated, and this actually revealed a lot of the wisdom of ancient Egypt, at least as had been preserved during the period, first, second century AD, when there were still pagan schools in Egypt. And they were very excited by this because they believed these teachings were much older than the teachings of Moses. Now, obviously, the Hermetica themselves weren't that old, but the teachings they were based on certainly were, and Moses himself is said to have had the wisdom of the Egyptians. So they were looking at these teachings of Hermes, who they equate with Enoch, and they see these as being much older than the teachings of Moses of the Bible. Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible. And therefore, they were pre-diluvian, before Noah's flood even, and therefore really precious. So they were studying these things in the Florentine Academy, and these would have been taught to Michelangelo, and in particular he would have been taught the concept of as above, so below, which is central to the Hermetic doctrine. That's a saying that's derived from the Hermetica. The idea that there's a macrocosmos and a microcosmos, man is in the image of God. So these things would have been in his mind. He would have known about these things from his schooling in the Florentine Academy. And he would also have learnt astronomy and probably astrology as well, or at least some of it. I mean, he's only there for, 4 years? But anyway, that was certainly been a good basis for his own studies later on in life. And throughout his life, Michelangelo was fascinated by anatomy. For the sake of artistic accuracy, he dissected cadavers, that's bodies, to see how the human body was beneath the skin. He would have had ample opportunities to study the brain. Now, he wasn't alone in that. Leonardo da Vinci was younger than him, and they knew each other. In fact, they were rivals. But Leonardo also studied human anatomy, and he probably got the idea from Michelangelo, because Michelangelo wanted to know how muscles were underneath the skin so he could paint them properly, get the proper proportions of the human body. No one had really done that since the time of the ancient Greeks. You know, the wonderful art that you see of the Parthenon and so on, beautifully represented bodies. So, throughout his life, Michelangelo is fascinated by anatomy. For the sake of artistic accuracy, he dissected cadavers to see how the human body was beneath the skin. He would have had ample opportunity to study the brain. As regards the Orion Nebula, this is the nearest one to us. I said that earlier. It can be seen as a smudge by those with good eyesight. To observe it in more detail would require a telescope of some sort. Now let's have a look a bit at telescopes and how they came about. Now, the official date for the invention of the telescope is 1608. In that year, a Dutch spectacle maker called Hans Lepinche applied for a patent for a telescope. And he was turned down, and it's not clear why, but it seems he was probably not the first to have invented the telescope. I mean, I don't want to libel the poor guy, but they must have had a reason for not giving him a patent. And I think that there probably were other telescopes of some sort around, and he wasn't able to prove that it was his invention. And in 1609, Galileo Galilei, famous scientist, Italian scientist, having heard of Lippershey's invention, made a telescope of his own. Well, he's quite up to that. And he was the most famous scientist of his time, so he made his own telescope. And he went on to make important observations of the moon. I think he's the first person, or so they say, to point a telescope at the moon. And he also turned the telescope on Jupiter and was the first to observe that it had four moons of its own. Now this is an important point, that up until that time nobody really, well, they didn't know that there are other moons in the sky apart from our moon. There was, you know, everyone knew our moon, but the idea that other planets had moons too and was shocking, quite shocking. In fact, the church didn't like this one little bit, as it kind of shook their notion that the Earth was at the centre of the universe, if other planets could have moons like we have. People then later went on to find the moons of Saturn, of course, with its beautiful rings. And then in modern times, we've discovered that there are moons going around Jupiter and Neptune and even Pluto. And even Mars has two very small moons. I mean, I wouldn't call those real moons. They look more like asteroids that have been captured by Mars to me. But nevertheless, they go around Mars. I don't think there's been a moon found around Venus or Mercury, but I could be wrong there. But anyway, so that it seems like having moons is quite normal. But at the time of Galileo, that was not understood or known at all. So these moons are now known as Galilean in his honour. However, we now know that Jupiter has considerably more moons than this, most of them being much smaller. I think Jupiter's got at least 30 moons that we know of, and Saturn has also got a huge complement as well. So having moons is not an unusual or unique thing. Now, Galileo, unfortunately, was doing his researches on the moon and planets 100 years after Michelangelo was working on the Sistine Chapel. So we can't say that Michelangelo got hold of Galileo's telescope and looked at Orion with that and found what he was looking for. Thus, if the observation by Danny Wilson that the picture of God in the creation of Adam scene was based on the Orion Nebula is correct, then this needs some explanation. Yeah, how is he able to see this? Is it possible that Michelangelo knew how to use lenses in such a way that they could behave as a telescope? To answer this question, we must examine the optics of telescopy, which need not be as complicated as the Hubble telescope is today. Certainly not. So here we have a simple diagram of a telescope. And on the right, you can see a large lens, and you can see parallel rays of light coming through that lens. And because it's a convex lens, it tends to concentrate the rays together, focusing them to a point where we've got those dotted lines going down. And then we've got a second lens, which is the eyepiece there, which takes those now expanding rays of light, they cross over and they're expanding again, and that lens is there to make them parallel again, otherwise they'll just go on expanding continuously. So we've got one end is a large lens with focal length f, yeah, you can see the long focal length f, and at the other end is a much smaller lens to act as the eyepiece, and this has a shorter focal length. The eyepiece is needed to bring the image into focus. What the telescope does is to magnify distant objects. Well, we know that. Now, lenses. Lenses are actually much older than you might imagine. I think it was Layard, a famous archaeologist, who was digging up at Nimrud, which is the ancient Assyrian city. Anyway, he found a convex lens made from clear quartz, which is a natural form of glass. They're mostly used as burning glasses. Well, I expect you've done this yourself. You can use a magnifying glass to concentrate the rays of the sun on a piece of paper or leaf or something. You can start a fire. So they were mostly used as burning glass, starting fires with light from the sun. However, they could also be used as magnifying glasses, just as we do today. And people weren't so stupid. I mean, you only have to pick one of these things up and you can see that it magnifies things, and you can hold it over things and you can see, oh yeah, makes it bigger. So people knew about that. They knew about magnifying glasses, and they made them out of clear quartz, or as clear as they could get. The Egyptians and Greeks made glass. They made actual glass, which you have to fuse sand to make. And they use that in jewellery. They put coloured metals in it to give brightly colours. cheaper way of doing things than having to rely on rubies and sapphires and emeralds and things. You can make paste, we call it paste jewellery, out of glass. However, the Romans perfected the technique of making glass bottles and other containers. They also learned how to blow glass, so you can make curved surfaces. So it's not that hard then to go from that step to making artificial lenses. And we know that a letter exists from 1462 written by Vincent Ilardi. It reveals that Francesco Sforza, Duke of Milan, ordered 3 dozen pairs of glasses from opticians in Florence, and 1 dozen were for long view, 1 for common view, which is astigmatism, and 1 dozen for short view. So he was doing that at a time that's long before the time, I mean, Michelangelo was born in 1475, so this is long before he was even born. So there were lenses kicking around Florence. There were people making glasses, spectacles, even back then, that you could put convex lenses in to cure long sight, and you could put concave lenses in to cure short sight. They knew about this even then. So if this guy was ordering lenses, then they would have been known to anyone else living in Florence at the time, and that would include Michelangelo. So we therefore know that lenses were being used in investigation in Florence in at least the mid-15th century. It's quite likely that Michelangelo observed the Orion Nebula using 2 aligned lenses. A telescope is really just 2 lenses being used together. So there's the diagram again. You can use 2 lenses in alignment without having them enclosed in a tube. I'll show you this. I've actually got 2 magnifying glasses here. Now imagine that is my large lens. Oh, it makes me a bit blurry in front. And imagine it's got a lens which is the same magnification as that, but it's got a small lens in the handle which is 4 times magnification. That's only 2, so this one can act as the eyepiece, and this one can act as the front piece. And all I have to do, you know, to see things clearly is to look through the eyepiece at just the right distance, and you can do that by holding one lens in one hand and the other in the other hand. So it's not a huge invention, the telescope. The idea of putting the 2 lenses inside a long tube is partly for convenience, you know, that you've got them readily aligned and you can have your eyepiece that slides in and out, you know, a smaller tube inside another one, so that you can adjust it for different distances. And I've actually got here a pair of binoculars. I haven't got a telescope, but a pair of binoculars can show this to you. Let me just take those off. One of the problems with using 2 lenses like I was doing just now is that it turns images upside down and back to front, because you've got to remember the rays from the first lens have come in, they've come to a focal point, and then they've crossed over and in 3 dimensions. And then they're moving, well, 2 dimensions, I suppose, and they're moving outwards they don't form an image unless you put the eyepiece in front, but when you do, everything is reversed. Now, that's all right if you're looking at the moon. All you do is you'll see the moon upside down and back to front. No problem, really. Looking for the moons of Jupiter. But really, what you need to do is you have to have some kind of a mirror system inside. And when you look at these binoculars, you've got your front lenses here and here, and you've got your eyepieces here and here, and you'll notice that the binoculars themselves, the alignment comes up this way, but this is not aligned with the eyepiece down there. So you're going to have some kind of mirror reflecting system to take the light that comes up here reflect it down to here and back up here. And in the process of doing that, obviously they re-reverse the image so that you're going to see it the right way up. In big telescopes, what they do is they put a mirror inside, and the light comes from the big lens in the front, comes down, reflects on that mirror up to an eyepiece, which is at right angle. So you look down inside, you have the tube of the telescope going that way, and you're looking down into it from the side to that mirror, and that again will reverse everything for you. So that's kind of how they got over that problem. But even so, Michelangelo, he could have been looking at the stars or whatever with a couple of lenses. It's not impossible. I'm not sure that is really what he did do, but I'm just showing you that this is not impossible. So people were obviously doing this long before 1608. All you needed to do is to hold a larger long focal length lens in one hand and a smaller, shorter focal length lens as an eyepiece in the other, then manipulate them in such a way that you'll look through them both, just as I did just now. To stabilize the image, these two lenses could be attached to a wooden slider. This would enable the telescope to be focused more easily. Mounting lenses at either end of an adjustable tube simply makes this device more portable. So imagine if you've got a long piece of wood and you have some kind of metal ring to hold your lens at one end, and then you've got the lens at the other end. If you had it at a fixed length suitable for infinity, then it'd be like opera glasses. You can only look at things that are distant. But if you had two pieces of wood that one could slide over the other or something, so that you could change the positions with the focal length, then you could use it to, like a telescope. Much better, obviously, if you put them inside a tube and you can slide them around, like Captain Hook or whatever, and you've got your portable telescope you can carry in your pocket. So that's one way that things could have been done. Now, Michelangelo may have made a crude telescope by mounting two lenses in a line. However, there is another way that he came by the image he painted. Possibly he did. He painted an image that he didn't realize represented both the mind of God and the Orion Nebula. So what if he was doing this and he wasn't actually conscious of exactly what he was painting? He just knew that he needed to paint it that way. That's what I'm saying here. There are two things we know about him. Firstly, he was a very devout Christian, which at the time meant Catholicism. I should say, before we go to that, the Reformation happened after he had painted the Sistine Chapel. So it's a few years after, about 5 years after, I think, that Luther pinned his articles to the door of Wittenberg Cathedral. Everyone who was a Christian in the West was a Catholic, but he was a very devout Catholic, not just in name only. Secondly, he had a very powerful imagination. He was able to see in his mind's eye exactly what he would then create with his hands. Now, I guess many artists do that, but a lot don't. A lot just experiment and wing it, do it as they go along. Given that much of our mind's working is unconscious to us, it is not impossible that the image he would paint as God creating Adam was implanted in his imagination from a higher source. So I'm suggesting here he had a sort of clairvoyance that the image would come into his mind, and very vividly, and then he would execute what he saw. Now we got some evidence for this from his letters, and particularly about Michelangelo's David, which is probably one of the most famous statues, if not the most famous statue in the world, and that's in Florence. Michelangelo's David, which he sculpted between 1501 to 1504, so that's sort of before the Sistine Chapel, which he started in 1508, so 4 years earlier. It's the most famous sculpture of the High Renaissance in Italy. It's therefore illuminating to hear what he says about its creation. I created a vision of David in my mind and simply carved away everything that was not David. Right, so he forms the image in his mind and then he carves out the statue exactly according to the image. I mean, what a man, what an incredible thing to be able to do. And Michelangelo tells us here that he used visualization of the finished product as a projection onto the material he was working with. In other words, he created the thought form of David in his mind first, and when projected, this form would itself guide his instruments as they carved away the excess marble that was obscuring it. Now, for those of us who are not sculptors, this must seem quite incredible, but you think of a musician who has the music in their mind and the hands play the notes. If they're skilled enough, they've learnt how to play the piano well enough that their hands know where all the notes are, and that part of it becomes automatic. They form in the mind or hear the melody in their head, and the hands just obey and do what the melody in the head is telling them. And it seems to be what he's saying here about doing his Michelangelo, that his mind is filled with the image and the hands are literally just almost working themselves. Obviously he's looking at what he's doing, but he doesn't have to be directing every tiny little cut. They're being guided by his higher mind. And there are two more quotes from Michelangelo, the greatest sculptor of the High Renaissance and maybe of all time. He says here, "In every block of marble I see a statue as plain as though it stood before me, shaped and perfect in attitude and action. I have only to hew away the rough walls that imprisoned the lovely apparition to reveal it to the other eyes as mine see it." So in other words, he is just doing this visualization onto the block of marble and creating this statue according to the image that's already in his head. And he says here, "I saw the angel in the middle and carved until I set him free." Amazing. So it's not unreasonable to think that he did the same when creating his paintings as his sculptures. The image formed in his mind and he painted what he saw. So he formed this image in his mind, he knew what he was going to paint, and then he just paints it. And given that much of our mind's working is unconscious to us, it is not impossible that the image he would paint as God creating Adam came to him from a higher source. Very likely he didn't realize that the image of God was a representation of both the brain of man and also the Orion Nebula. We can call him a prophet in the sense that, like St. John, who wrote the Apocalypse, he had visions that are only understandable now that we have pictures taken by the Hubble telescope. So in other words, he was clairvoyantly receiving this image. This is what I'm thinking happened. He received this image. It was bright as anything in his mind. He could see it. Yeah, this is what I have to paint. But that image has come to him from a higher source. Let's say from the mind of God. Paint this. He doesn't need to be conscious of what he's painting. He just does it because that's the image that has formed in his head. And that's like St. John the Divine writing the Apocalypse. He has all these complex images which nobody can understand. It's only now that we can begin to decode that whole thing, because now is the time of the Apocalypse. I've done 20 lectures on that so far, and there are more going to be coming soon. So in the next episode, we will carry on with our investigation into the mysteries of Orion. We'll look at its religious significance throughout the ages and in different countries and cultures. So, I hope you enjoyed this lecture. I know it's a bit different from some, but I think we need to begin to take on board, and your members of the college, and you're ready for this, to understand that our minds are not just what we're conscious of. There are things going on in our heads that we're not conscious of that come into consciousness. And that's actually how all clairvoyance works. And it's actually how intuition works. And it's actually how dreams work. So we're saying here that Michelangelo, this most gifted sculptor, but also a great painter, produced his marvelous masterpieces through images that came into his mind and executed them into the natural world. And we're going to go on now in the next lecture, and we'll look at Orion from a different perspective, and we'll see even more about why it's an important constellation for us here on Earth. So thank you very much for your time, and I'll put those links down below, and you can have a look at those other websites or links, whatever they are. So thank you very much.